Hey, hold on. I'm just trying to make sure things are going here. Let's make sure I'm broadcasting. That's a commercial. How'd that get on? Ooh. Hold on. Let me turn off the commercials. Hold, please. I'm turning off the commercials. Okay, I turned off the commercials. Much better. Hi, welcome to my office hours. Every other week, I have these office hours where I answer your questions on Facebook, YouTube, the Ask Scooby Forum, and from my special friends. Oh, and anyask.com. Before we get started here, let me make sure you can hear me. I'm hoping you guys can hear me. Let me know. And I'm hoping the video's actually working. I'm trying some new software here. Before we get started, we're going to talk about cardio equipment. A lot of people ask this time of year what they can buy to do cardio indoors because it's snowing or icy outside. Well, first of all, the easiest requires nothing. Do burpees. You can do them completely naked if you want. You don't even need shoes to do burpees. That's one really cheap option. The next option for cardio, your tennis shoes. You already own these. Just go for a jog. Awesome cardio. Getting slightly more expensive, a jump rope. You can get these for 10 or 15 bucks. Awesome cardio. But you need high ceilings, as we talked about last time. But so if none of those, suit your fancy, and you want something that is more like a gym quality exercise machine for indoor cardio. Let's talk about some different things that you need to keep in mind. Where is my? If I had a brain, where would I have put it? It's in there. There's three things you need to think about when you're buying cardio equipment. The first is it needs to exercise a major muscle group. You can't get cardio unless you're really stressing your lungs and heart. And to do that, you have to work a major muscle like legs or perhaps lats for rows or something like that. You can't get cardio doing curls. You can't get cardio doing a twisty ab exercise. It's got to be legs or lats. That's pretty much what you can use for cardio. The second is the piece of machine needs a way to dissipate the energy that you're giving to it. And that is virtually always in the form of heat. One exception that we'll talk about later. So a good piece of cardio equipment will have a way to dissipate a lot of heat. So fins or high mass. The third thing that a good piece of cardio equipment will have typically is a lot of weight. I don't know of any exceptions here. All the good cardio equipment is heavy, meaning you can't curl it. It's that heavy. Let's look at some pictures here. So this is a typical cardio machine at a bike. It's a stationary bike that you'd find at a gym. This is great. These are probably $500 to $1,000, not really suitable for home use. They're really heavy, and you can't see it, but underneath that plastic cover, there's a generator and then a heat sink that it dumps the heat into. So this thing gets hot when you're cycling on it. So that's a real expensive alternative. Let's look at some cheaper ones that you could buy indoors. Let me give you an example of one that will not work. So this is supposed to be a stationary bike. You move your chair up to it and move your feet. So it's exercising your legs, which is the big muscle group. But what's missing from this? There is no way to dissipate the heat. You're just spinning your legs. You are not going to get a workout using that piece of equipment. So now it's test time. I'm going to show you some pieces of equipment, and you tell me whether you think that these are good machines for cardio or not. Okay, let's start with this one. What do you think? This is the Ab Circle Pro. Is this going to give you a good cardio workout? What's the answer there? I think you probably all know that that is not. Two problems with that one. First, it's exercising your abs, which are not big enough to do cardio. You need to do legs or lats. The other problem is there's no way to dissipate the heat on that. So it's a double failure. Let's look at another piece of equipment here. How about this one? This is a stationary bike, moves your hands. Is this going to give you a good cardio workout? What do you think? I'm looking for answers on YouTube here. What do you people say? Okay, the correct answer, that was kind of a trick actually. That is actually a good piece of cardio equipment. There's no place to dissipate the heat, but that's a big fan and it moves a lot of air. So it actually is dissipating heat, but it's by heating up the air in the room, all just a small amount. So that's actually a good piece of cardio equipment. Those are actually a relatively inexpensive option for a piece of cardio equipment. Let's look at another one here. Okay, oh, here's an awesome one. So tell me what you think about this. Is this a good piece of cardio equipment? Works your legs. You stand in that and it's like running. You grab the handles and it's like running in place. Okay, as you probably suspected, this is not a good piece of cardio equipment because there's nothing to dissipate the energy there. It's just swinging your legs in space. That's not going to do anything for you. Let's look at one more. Let's see. How about... oh, here, excellent. So tell me what you think of this one. Is this a good piece of cardio equipment? You stand on those pads, grab the handle, and twist from side to side. Okay, as you probably guessed, no. It's working your abs, you're twisting from side to side, and there's nothing to dissipate the energy, and the whole thing probably you could lift with one finger. That's a typical infomercial exercise device. So remember, if you're looking for indoor cardio, if you are gonna buy one, first of all, you don't have to. You can do burpees, you can go running, you can do jump rope, but if you buy a piece of equipment, get it used on Craigslist and make sure it's heavy, make sure it works out a major muscle group like legs or a rowing machine, lats, and make sure it's heavy. That's how you find a good piece of fitness equipment. Enough of that, let's answer your questions. I'm gonna go to YouTube and answer some questions there. Hold on, let me refresh here to get some questions. Here's a comment from someone from Yuli XXXL on YouTube. Can just dance for cardio. Actually, that is true. A lot of the indoor gym classes are dance related. And as long as you get your heart rate up, it is great cardio, but measure your heart rate if you're doing dancing. Especially if you do it like a step class where you're doing dances, but you're stepping up on a large platform, those can be awesome cardio. And it's obviously a lot more interesting for some people than doing sitting on a bike, just spinning their feet. I personally like sitting on a bike, but dancing is an option. Here's an interesting question from Rally Silvers on YouTube. Is there a minimum age to start using whey protein? Whey is food. It's part of milk. So is there a minimum age for eating food? Well, not really. But are you getting any benefit from it if you're a teenager? Not in my opinion. You should be able to get everything you need from normal good nutrition that your parents give you. Don't waste money on supplements and whey protein at that age, please. Let me answer a couple more on YouTube here. Okay, this is a good question from Dichotic 2. How do I get past a fat loss plateau? This is a very common question. I've been at a 1,700 calorie diet 4 days a week, strength training for 15 to 30 minutes after each workout. Hold on a sec. Let's see. Weight loss plateau. Try that again. Just searching on my website here. Okay, hold on. So if you go to my website, then you're burning off. What you need to do is either eat less or do more exercise. What's going to happen, at first you start losing weight, and then your body weight gets to a point where it's burning off fewer calories because your basal metabolic rate is less. The less you weigh, the less you burn. So eventually you just reach a new equilibrium. So every time your weight goes down by like 5 pounds, you have to reuse the calorie calculator and recalculate how many calories you should be consuming. Good question. Let me go to Facebook, my Facebook fan page, and answer some questions there. And then I'm going to head over to the Ask Scooby forum next. Okay. This question is from Haver Malik. Hey Scoob, I broke my left thumb and my left knee. Any workouts I can still possibly do? Okay, that's a bummer. Left thumb and left knee. Wow. Well, cardio is going to be tough if you can't use your knee. With a thumb, you could still use a hand bike for upper body, so you can get some cardio that way. As far as other exercises you can do, a lot. A thumb injury isn't that bad. Certainly listen to the doctor, but if you have access to a gym, anything that has pads you can use, like pads that push on your elbows. So you could do a pec deck, you could do curls on a machine. Obviously you're not going to be doing anything with your broken knee, but do what you can. Just don't do anything the doctor says not to. Okay, let's take another question from Facebook here. Let's see. Wow, a lot of questions on injuries here. This is from Felix. I have tendonitis on my right wrist, so working out upper body is pretty difficult. Do you have any ideas for working out upper body without stressing my wrist? As a matter of fact, I do. Let me find that here. Let's see. Hold on. Going to my website, injuries, working around injuries. Hold on. You what I'm doing here.
Going to my website.
So this is where injuries, it is in the menu. So injuries.
Working around injuries.
Show you what I'm doing here.
Going to my website.
So this is where it is in the menu.
There's a lot you can do
if you have hand, wrist, or elbow.
There's a lot you can do if you have
hand, wrist, or elbow. Just got a wrist or hand injury. Let's see. Let's take another question from Facebook here. Okay, this is from Anal. What happens if I'm eating too much fiber? I'm getting 109 grams per day at the moment. Honestly, I'm not. You can start consuming fiber too quickly. If you're normally eating McDonald's and Twinkies and you immediately switch to a high fiber natural food diet, your system's going to have real trouble accommodating that fiber. But if you ramp up slowly over a couple months, I'm not sure there is such a thing as too much fiber, as long as you're getting it from natural sources like vegetables. Obviously, if you chug a couple buckets of Metamucil, you know, I wouldn't be surprised if that can kill you. Too much of anything is a bad thing. So let's see. Oh, I just have to share with you something funny from Facebook here. Hold on. This just cracked me up. This website that I did, Big Muscle Shortcuts, okay, let's go to the Ask Scooby forum. See if there's any questions there. Okay, this is from Calvin. How much muscle did you gain each year during your first few years of training, and what would you estimate your total gains were? Let me preface this by saying I started in the dark ages, literally before the internet was around. There was no good information. There was no such thing as a website. At most, there were bulletin boards. Miss.fitness.weights was like the one thing that was out there, but I didn't discover that till later. So I kind of made every mistake in the book. So, you know, my gains per year were not what you could do if you did things the right way, the way I would do them now. So I'd have to say, you know, when I started out, even my newbie gains were only 5 to 10 pounds per year. So my weight ramped up very slowly over my history. It wasn't until I'd been working out maybe 20 years that I hit my genetic max. So, you know, people today have their gains quicker and level off quicker. But I was a tortoise, not a hare, when it came to this. Still, let's see. And Calvin also asked, what would I estimate my total gains were? I'd have to say I started at 180, and then got up to 230. I'm at 222 now, at about 7% body fat. So anyway, that answers Calvin's question. This question is from Moon. Hi, Moon. Longtime poster from the Ask Scooby forum. He actually has 10,644 posts. Way to go, Moon. Recommended resources for trainers. Good question. I have some listed on the book recommendations on my website. Actually, let me show you that quick. Hold on. Recommendations on my website. Actually, let me show you that quick. Hold on. Recommendations on my website. Actually, let me show you that quick.
Let's see.
Hold on. Recommendations on my website. Actually, let me show you that. Can't show you that one.
Let's see.
Hold on. This is actually my favorite. This book here.
Let me show you that.
Can't show you that one. This is a book sold by Ace.
This is actually my favorite.
This is a really good book.
Let me show you that.
Can't show you that one.
This is a book.
The reason I really like this.
Ace.
A lot of people ask.
This is actually my favorite.
Let me show you that.
Can't show you that one.
You know, how do I work out this muscle, or what does this exercise work? And they have pictures of the way all the muscles are connected in the body, and it guides you through figuring out which ones are being used at any particular movement. So it's, you know, you don't have to be a doctor and know the name of every single last muscle and attach point in the body to understand the mechanics of the body. So that is actually my favorite book. Good question, man. Let's see. This is from a question from the Hit Kitchen on the Ask Scooby forum. If one were to eat below maintenance, 20% below, without adequate protein intake, would the person lose more muscle than fat, or vice versa? What I always tell people is don't cut your calories more than 20% below your maintenance, your TDEE. And the reason is when you cut it more than that, you're risking losing muscle, especially if your nutrition is not flawless. Could you do 21% below maintenance without losing muscle? You know, maybe. Could you do 30%? My guess is you couldn't do 30 without losing muscle. The slower you lose the fat, the easier it is going to be to do it without losing muscle. And it depends on two things: how much sleep you're getting and the quality of your nutrition. Sleep makes a huge difference. If you're in a caloric deficit and don't get enough sleep, there's this great research study. I have it on my website on the sleep and bodybuilding page, where it shows that if you're at a caloric deficit and don't get enough sleep, your body loses muscle instead of fat. And if you get enough sleep, you lose the fat and not the muscle. So it's doubly important to get enough sleep when you're at a caloric deficit. So great question there. Okay, this is from Metal. Did you ever, or have you ever done jump rope? I own it, but I have to admit, the most I've done it is 60 seconds. The problem is, twofold. One, I have nowhere to do it anywhere in my house or in the yard. everything is low ceilings and I'm tall, and everywhere in the yard there's trees and bushes, so there's no place I can possibly swing a rope. I can tell you it's a lot harder than it looks. Those of you that think jumping rope is for little girls have not tried it. So if you want to be humbled, give it a try. It's actually, I think, even better exercise when you're bad, because you end up jumping higher because you don't have the timing down. People who are really good with the jump rope can just jump that far off the ground and do all kinds of tricks and do it long term, because they're skillful enough at it that they can do it expending less energy than a spaz like me, who's, you know, jumping 8 inches up in the ground to try to avoid the rope. So you won't find any videos of me doing jump rope. Okay, Barry Donovan just let me know that my audio is feedbacking when I show the... Okay, thank you. Thank you for that. I won't do that anymore. I'm going to go to my special friends and answer some questions there, and then I'm going to go to anyask.com. Let's see if there's any questions here. Okay, this question is from Anonymous. I was going to ask how much exercise you're getting from that plane building project. You know, not a lot. Although, strangely enough, I got some really strange overuse injuries from doing the rib stitching. Rib stitching is where you're... So there's a fabric cover over the wing, and you need to attach the fabric to the ribs by stitching. So you run a needle up and around through the wing, and then you tie it off with this knot, and you really have to pull hard. Well, after doing that for 8 or 10 hours, the next day, my shoulder was so sore that I couldn't do anything. I was like an invalid. And I was thinking, what is wrong? What have I done? And then I realized, it's like I went out to work on the plane and tie one more knot and felt the pain right in the same spot. Just goes to show, it doesn't matter how strong you are or how complete you think your workouts are, everyday life can kick your butt. Oh, let's see. There's a question I won't answer. I won't tell you what the question is, but the answer is, no, I won't even say that. Okay, here's a question from Anonymous. Why are my legs so small? Well, I'm not a T-Rex. I do not do strength training. My sports are volleyball, which is a lot of ballistic movements, and endurance events. I do the half Ironman and 200-mile bike races. So my form follows function. If you do those kind of things, your legs will not be in T-Rex mode. That's why they're not. I work out legs. I just work them out differently than strength trainers. So that's that. Do I enjoy being known as the puzzle master? Yes, I have some great images of me photoshopped on the Joker's body that I love. Okay, there's a good answer. Thank you. Someone told me how to answer the question from anyask.com. Question, elliptical, yay or nay? The expensive elliptical machines are awesome. the ones that you find at a gym that are real heavy and expensive, the knockoffs that you get on the late night infomercial devices, they don't do anything. Remember, they got to be heavy and they have to have a way to dissipate the heat. If they do that, they're good. Let's see. Let me answer a few more questions from my special friends here, and then I'm going to go to anyask.com. I need to give a shout out to Isaac and Christopher from Canada. Done. Looking for another question here. What do I think of Freight Yang? I've only seen one of his videos, the one where he's playing the violin in the gym. I thought it was very funny. I am going to go to anyask.com and answer some questions there, and then I'm going to head back to YouTube. Okay, the question is, who/what are the special friends? They are an elite group of fitness experts. I just have to get that in writing. Okay, let me answer another question from anyask.com. Waiting. The question is, the peak in the biceps you get from doing preachers. Okay. I'm not going to answer the exact question. The question is, can you do a particular exercise to work on the peak of your bicep? You know, I'm not a big proponent of that. I say just do a well-rounded arm workout, which includes triceps. Actually, the triceps are even more important. And don't worry about trying to do peaking exercises. Most of that's genetics anyway. The shape of your bicep is the way it is, and you're not going to change it by doing ballerina curls or whatever. Let's see. Here's another question I'm not going to completely answer. Another question from anyask.com. Why keep your body at vertical when you're doing dips? Your shoulder is still moving, not totally isolating the triceps. I typically do not recommend dips because they can be really hard on the shoulder. A lot of people do them incorrectly too. They get this swinging motion. I can't even demonstrate it, but they end up using momentum and it just gets really ugly really fast. So, you know, if you want a good triceps exercise, I would recommend the laying French press, skull crushers, whatever you want to call them. That's what I would do for triceps. Let me go back to YouTube. Answer some questions there. Oh, sorry, I'm going to go to my blog post. There's some questions there. Okay, this is from Alex asking, on exercise like dumbbell curls or dumbbell shoulder press, you can perform them one arm at a time or with both at the same time. Is there any difference or is it just a matter of preference? There is a difference. The big thing I find is in how easy it is to cheat. For example, in curls, a lot of people, when they do them one arm at a time, they'll kind of go like this, and they'll use the momentum. It's a little tougher to cheat if you're doing simultaneous. The other difference is the time under load. If you're doing one arm at a time, there's a lot more time under tension, because while this arm's lifting, this arm is just sitting here doing nothing. So you're getting some dynamic and static at the same time. So this is, you could actually do a lot more weight if you're doing it this way than if you're doing it this way. So it's just, as long as your form is good, it's not going to matter that much. It's just a different way of working out. That was a good question. Okay. This is from PN on my blog posting. Hello, Scooby. I've been working out for 8 months, and I'm now muscular with low body fat. How'd you do that after 8 months? Why am I having trouble believing this? However, I keep having a problem with pain in my shoulders every time I work them out. I think it's a tendon. Okay. Pain in the joints is not good. It's even worse that you just started and you're already having shoulder problems. Don't mess with joint problems. Stop everything that's causing them any discomfort or pain. Ice 3 times a day and make a doctor's appointment, because joint problems typically do not solve themselves. It's possible that just doing some rotator strengthening exercises might get you fixed, but you've already screwed up your shoulder and you've only been doing this 8 months. So my guess is you're lifting too much weight with bad form. Okay. This is from Yo-Yo on my blog posting. If I work out shoulders and lats, I don't feel any soreness the next day. But if I work out biceps or chest, I feel soreness. So my question is, am I doing something wrong? Okay, delayed onset muscle soreness, DOMS. I have a section on that on my website, but I'm not going to show you. You can look that up if you want. Being sore is just one indication it was a good workout. If you're sore, if the muscles are sore the next day, yeah, it was a good workout. The converse is not true. You cannot say, I was not sore the next day, so I did not have a good workout. That's not true. You can have a great workout and not be sore the next day. Some people get sore, some don't. Some muscles on some people get sore and while the others don't. It's quite common for big muscles like legs. Virtually everyone can get their legs so sore that they can't even walk upstairs the next day or 2 days later. On the other hand, a muscle like shoulders is a little tougher to get that kind of soreness without getting injured. So don't worry about it. It is what it is. Give the workout 110%. If you're sore, great. If you're not, great. What's important is you get a little stronger every month. Yo-Yo asks, can I do a video on swimming for beginners? I'm out of my league there. I'm going to let people who swim far better than I do give the swimming instruction. Let me go back to YouTube and answer some questions there. Holy cow, 311 new comments. Okay, this is from ZS2A on YouTube. Is walking good cardio for losing fat if I'm already in decent shape? I jog and jump rope, but sometimes I just want to walk. Walking, even if you're in great shape, walking can be great cardio, but make sure you do brisk walking. Keep your pace up. You know, you don't need to be a a race walker, but, you know, walk really fast. Make sure you're perspiring a little. If you're sauntering along, it's walking a miniature dog, you're not going to get much exercise. So it's good to break it up now and then and do walking, long duration walking, like 30, 60 minutes now and then. If you feel like doing that instead of walking or instead of jogging or riding the bike, awesome. Okay, here's a question from Khalid110. Are there substitute exercises for chest flies, excluding machines? Well, when it comes to chest, there's two kinds of exercises. There's a pushing exercise, and then there's a squeezing type exercise. What you're basically saying is you don't want to do the squeezing exercises. That's fine. You can just do pushing. Half of America just does bench press. You'll limit your ability to gain strength and mass if you just do bench. But, you know, most people have overdeveloped pecs compared to the rest of the body anyway. So, okay, here's a question from Kill the Bad Guy on YouTube. Scooby, is it true that you really need to go low carb to get your lower abs to show? Absolutely not. There's so many things wrong with that, I don't know where to start. Getting your lower abs to start to show, first of all, the only reason the lower abs are tough to show, to get them visible, is because that's the last place the fat comes off when you're lowering your body fat. Because that's the first place it goes on, right here and right here on your love handles. Last to come off. So you just need to keep reducing your body fat until it comes off of the area that's over your lower abs. It makes no difference as long as you're having good nutrition. A calorie is a calorie. It doesn't matter if that excess calorie is carb, protein, fat. If there's an excess calorie, it's going right over your lower abs. So keep your caloric deficit at maybe 10%, maybe 20%. Keep losing that body fat. Have good nutrition, and it'll come off of the area that's covering your lower abs. Let's see. Where haven't I been? Let me go back to the Ask Scooby forum, and then I'll go back to Facebook. Seamus recommends, I recommend you put Planet Fitness in the Hall of Shame. I believe I saw a picture that was rather funny. There was a Planet Fitness sign. I think it said, anyone caught deadlifting will have their membership revoked. Thank you, the Planet Fitness staff. That is... you know, personally, I don't do the strength training exercises, but I think it's ridiculous that gyms do not allow that. If you can't do squatting, deadlifting in a gym, where can you do it? You know, a little chalk dust isn't going to kill anyone. Let's see. This is from Joe11 on the Scooby forum. He's 6'2", 155. He's pretty lean. He'd like to gain muscle, but maintain a thin waist. That being said, he wants to get his body fat percentage as low as possible. Okay. First of all, you're tall. You're 6'2". You're 155 pounds. At this point, getting a low body fat probably should not be a priority for you. You obviously shouldn't get fat, but whatever your body fat now is, I would maintain or let it go up slightly. Just focus on getting stronger and gaining some muscle mass. You can work on the low body fat later. You don't say, well, you're a teenager, yeah. So, I unless you have a very good reason for putting low body fat as your number one priority, I don't think I would do that. Okay, let me, where did I say I was going? I said I was going to Facebook. Facebook fan page, let me go there. Loading, loading. Interesting question from Chris Crippler. Can drumming or boxing or other activities requiring a lot of arm movements overtrain your arms? I think, well, as far as drumming goes, I think that's probably more a joint overuse issue. But, you know, it's very possible that you could have forearm problems from doing too much drumming, wrist and elbow too. I don't think it's as much a muscle problem as a joint problem that you would have. As far as boxing, yeah, you know, if you're boxing or doing a punching bag all day, that's a lot of arm activity, and you're going to have to work to plan your resistance training around that. You might not even do any if you're doing a lot of bag work. Your body doesn't necessarily care where the exercise is coming from. If you have too much from all the combined sources, it's going to be overtraining. This is from Adam. Does eating fish or red meat every day help you maximize your gains? You need protein. The recommended amount is typically 1 gram per pound of body weight per day. There's a number of other things. It can't just be any protein. It needs to be high quality protein. So, you know, wheat has protein in it, but the quality is pretty low, as does corn. Soy is better than those two, but not nearly as good as beef. Chicken is better than beef, and eggs and dairy are better than chicken. So, and actually I think fish is up there about with dairy. So you need protein from good quality sources. Let's see. Okay, this is from Alistair. Hi Scooby, when I'm lifting, I suffer a sharp pain in my wrist. Bad sign so far here. Although I can lift the weight, I'm doing good form. Is this arthritis, weak wrists? What can you do to strengthen them? This is not a strength issue. You have an issue with your wrists. And it's not going to get better by doing more exercise. It's only going to get better if you stop doing whatever is causing pain or discomfort in your wrist. I would start by, you know, immobilizing it, icing it a few times a day, and make that doctor's appointment. Hopefully, by the time you get the doctor's appointment, your pain will be gone and you can cancel it. But you know, it's possible you've done something to your wrist. So less exercise rather than more. Let me go to my special friends and see if they have some more questions. Question. You know, it's easier to find questions if they're in photos. Here's one I can't read. I was doing skateboard squats, as you suggested. Yesterday, I was doing them again, and one of the wheels broke off and flew. Never mind. Okay, I'm not seeing any more questions there. I'm going to go to anyask.com. The noise level was a little too high there. This is a question from anyask.com. Studies show that high-intensity sprinting boosts growth hormone naturally by a ton. Worth trying for bodybuilding. The question is, what is a ton and how long does it boost the growth hormone? If it just boosts it a couple hours, it's unclear if that's going to do any good. So, you know, I'm not sure that's going to help a bodybuilder. I'd like to say yes, just because I'd love to give people an excuse to do cardio instead of avoiding it. It's like, yeah, do sprints. You got to if you're a bodybuilder to gain muscle. I'm not quite so convinced. Having said that, you know, you look on track and field competitions, and the sprinters are the ones with the huge muscular legs. So it's obviously working for their legs. Is it going to help their upper body? I'm guessing probably not, but never know. Let's see. Let me go to... I'm going to head back to the Ask Scooby forum. No more questions there. So I'm going to head to Facebook. Oh, sorry. No, I'm heading to YouTube. I haven't been there. Where's YouTube? Okay, here we are. Oh! 200 new comments. Am I a bear or a Twinkie? I don't quite get that. Question is, why don't I get a pump when I train chest and shoulders? What does it mean that the workouts are not effective? Honestly, people when you chase a pump in your workout, I think you're losing sight of what's important. I think a lot of people get injured chasing a pump. Some things you just don't get a pump. And remember, what you're trying to do is every week, every month, make a little progress in terms of strength. Chasing a pump kind of distracts you from that goal. So I would say don't follow the pump. Okay, this is from Spike the Spider. He asked, do I ever drink? Yes, I drink alcohol on occasion. Alcohol is a simple sugar and it's a junk calorie. Whether you can afford a junk calorie or not depends on your goals and the other parts of your nutrition. You know, if you're trying to gain muscle and lose fat at the same time, you don't really have any discretionary calories. So alcohol is out, cookies out, everything. However, if you're stable at a certain body fat and lean body mass, and you just want to maintain, you have a lot more discretionary calories. I'm in that category. I do a lot of cardio. I'm not trying to gain muscle because I can't anyway. So I have more discretionary calories. So yeah, I have drink on occasion. Let's see. Let me answer another question from YouTube here. Mike Love asks, how can I lose 60 pounds? You can lose them 1 pound at a time. And probably at about 1 pound a week. So you can lose that 60 pounds in 60 weeks. Any faster, you're risking losing muscle mass.
Tranquility 321 asks, Scooby, is it possible to make a working car out of a plank of wood and a bit of string? I don't know. We'd have to ask MacGyver, but I don't think so. The hardest thing in making a wooden engine is that it kind of burns up when you put gas in it. Answer some more questions from YouTube here. Okay, this is from Just PLZ. What kind of fish do you have? You can see behind me there, those are angel fish and one pearl grommy. And over there I have, you can kind of see it, the reflection in the mirror, there's two tiger Oscars. So that's, there, Sammy the turtle's in the other room. This question is from Fender Marshall on YouTube. Hi Scooby, do you ever eat whole grain bread? Hey, you haven't mentioned in your videos, wondering if you think it's a good food option. I don't eat a lot of bread. I have nothing against carbs. I eat a lot of carbs, but I much prefer to get my carbs. Number one favorite, oats. Why? It's a complex carbohydrate with lots of fiber. Fiber is awesome. So I'd much rather get have some oats, some oatmeal than bread. Also, I love beans. Beans are an awesome complex carbohydrate that have a lot of high quality protein in them too. So, you know, that's where I get my carbs from. I'm not so much a bread fan. Every once in a while, you know, I'll have breads with eggs on weekend, but you know, it gets used so seldom that the bread stays in the freezer. So that kind of lets you know how often I have bread. Scooby, why is your name Scooby? I think I answer that on my website. I'm going to make you look for it. Let's see. Let me go to, I'm going to head over to Facebook. That's where I said I was going before and answer some questions there. Okay, this is from Joseph. High intensity interval training or slow cardio? It depends. It depends on who you are, how experienced you are, and what your limitations are. Yes, doing interval training is more efficient in terms of burning off more calories in less time. However, it also is more likely to get you injured. If you're someone who's overweight and a newcomer to fitness and you start doing intervals, I guarantee you, you are going to pull a hamstring or destroy your knee or something like that. So doing interval training is not for beginners. If you're an experienced, advanced athlete, intervals are great. It's a great way to not only burn off calories, but more importantly, it's a way to help increase your speed. You know, that's why people do intervals a lot of time, is to help their running speed. So a lot of reason to do intervals, but if you just want to burn off calories, the safest way to do it is the low intensity steady state, walking, riding bikes, swimming, etc. Okay, this is from Yosef. The whole cold therapy thing. what's my view on cold showers after working out versus warm showers? You could extend that. You know, there's been there was one experiment where, you know, this guy puts his arm in the cold therapy machine and experienced a lot of gains. For me, the jury is still out on that one. You know, it's hopeful, but, you know, I'm still not convinced. The other problem is, if you're working out in a freezing cold room, as some people propose doing to you know, get additional gains, there's reasons you don't train in a cold room. You're more likely to get injured and pull a muscle if you're shivering when you're working out. So, you know, perhaps the cold therapy works. It does burn off more calories. Your body spends an immense amount of its calories in your BMR just keeping your body warm. If you make your body cold with ice or cold showers, whatever, your body has to burn more calories to keep your body temperature at 98.6. So, yeah, it's burning off more calories. The question is, you know, is that the easiest way to burn off your calories? And are there bad consequences that you don't want to deal with? So, jury's still out on that one. You won't catch me doing freezing cold showers or ice cube baths or anything like that. This is a related question from Gaurav from India. Is doing high intensity cardio good for fat loss or low intensity but longer duration? You know, I can't give you a precise comparison because it's going to depend on, you know, your steady state cardio. How intense is it? How many beats per minute versus what kind of intervals are you doing and how long? I wouldn't let that be your guide. You know, if you're an athlete, really good shape, tight on time, you want to burn off the calories, definitely go for interval training. But if you're just someone starting out who's overweight, don't even consider the interval training, because if you get injured, you're going to be much worse off than had you just done something simple like walking. Because once you get injured, you can't do anything, and you're going to have even a harder time losing the weight. We're over. I'll go till 10 after 5 here. Let's see. I need to go back to my blog and answer some more questions there. Am I going to do a pose? No, sorry. We'll leave that for all the other people on. On the internet. Let me see if I can find any questions here amongst the noise. I love this comment. He knows what to expect and he's been here long enough. How can anyone come here and not have developed a thick skin is beyond me. Here's an interesting question. Is there a point to doing isolation exercises while you're cutting? Well, it depends on what you mean by cutting. When I'm talking about cutting, what I'm talking about is doing a rather gradual fat reduction, meaning 10 or 20% below your TDEE. And in that case, just continue doing your normal workout routine, whatever that is. But I think what you're asking is, a lot of people do what I do not recommend. They do bulking and cutting, and in the cut part, they cut their calories drastically because they want to get rid of that fat really fast, and they're willing to sacrifice some muscle to do that. I don't like doing that, but you know, if you're going to cut your calories 50% below maintenance, you know, you might as well not work out at all, as far as I'm concerned. You know, you're not getting enough protein. You're losing muscle anyway. So I'd say don't work out at all if you're going to cut your calories that much. Any tips for dealing with tendonitis in the collarbone? It's keeping me from doing dips, and I really want to do heavy dips. I've never heard of tendonitis in the collarbone. That does not sound pleasant. The way you deal with tendonitis is, one, you stop doing anything that causes any pain or discomfort at all. You can use icing. And you're going to need to make an appointment with a doctor if it doesn't go away on its own. Sometimes it doesn't, but I can guarantee you, if you keep doing things that hurt it, it is not going to get better. It's going to either stay the same or get worse. So, you know, you got to decide. Here's an interesting question. Scoobys, why does a cardio machine need to dissipate heat? The reason is, the whole purpose of cardio, doing cardiovascular exercise, is to give your heart and lungs a workout, to push them near capacity. And to do that, your body has to do work. And to do work, you need to have resistance. And so if you're pushing or spinning something, to get resistance, that energy has to go somewhere. It can't just go into thin air. So you could turn that energy into electricity and power light in the ceiling. But what virtually every machine out there does is it takes that energy that you're providing and turns it into heat. So you can gauge how much work you're doing by how hot the exercise bike or piece of equipment is getting. So the energy has to go somewhere. It can't just disappear. So that's why a cardio machine needs to dissipate heat. If it's not, you're not doing any exercise. You know, am I doing cardio right now? No, not really. I'm not doing any work. I'm not pushing. There's no force. So good question. Let's see. I'm going to answer one more question from YouTube and then call it a day. Remember, by the way, so I'm doing office hours every other week, so expect in 2 weeks from today, whenever that is, I'll be doing office hours again at the same time. And no video this week. I'm alternating office hours and videos. So let me answer one more question here. Let's see. What do I think about workouts with suspension systems like TRX? You know, there's all kinds of workouts. Depends on your goals. One thing I could say definitely is, please do not go out and buy the TRX suspension system. Not that it's bad, but it's really expensive. Get a door mount or a pull-up bar mount version, or make your own out of rope if you're going to do this. It's just another way to do body weight exercises, and give you a lot more options. Good workout, but you know, it depends on your goals. That's it for today. Thank you for joining me for my office hours, and I will see you in 2 weeks. Happy holidays, and I guess it'll be after the holidays that I see everyone. Feeder Zane.